Three,
I suppose.
Two, one.
I'm so nervous.
All right.
Did we start?
Hello there, and welcome to The Found Cause, where we have found our cause in serving the Lord Jesus Christ. I am Michael, the man behind the machine, and to my left is...
Isaiah, and I'm the one behind the heresy.
Oh.
No, okay, just kidding. We'll get into it.
You gotta embrace your nickname.
Okay, yeah.
I would, you know, call a different nickname, but whatever. And then to my right is...
Theodore, the man behind the book.
The book? Which book?
I don't know.
The good book?
One of the books.
So, you've taken heresy, I've taken machines, and Theodore takes the scripture.
Right. I was thinking Edward Fudge. Edward Fudge's book.
Ah, yes.
I think that's what he meant.
Which throws us into today's topic immediately. No fun around here. We got to get straight into the thick of things, which is...
Straight into hell.
Straight into hell, because that's today's topic. So, hell's a really sticky topic. It's one that people get really upset about, and... You know, rightfully so, because hell is super serious. And as much as we like to laugh, as Christians and on this podcast, I think that we won't get away with not laughing on this podcast. If anybody's offended with some giggles in an episode about hell, and I'm sorry. You know, I'm not super serious when maybe I should be, but it's a serious topic. So we've got three different opinions here on the podcast today. In fact, not unusual. So we're going to present three different views of hell, Christian views of hell. That doesn't mean we agree with the particular ones we present, but we'll give our opinions after we present. So, without further ado, our first view of hell is going to be presented by you, Isaiah. Ready?
I'm kicking this one off.
Yeah.
Cool. All right. Well, I am presenting Gregory MacDonald's and Robin Perry's perspective. It is called Universalism. The evangelical approach to universal reconciliation. So, without further ado, I'll start.
Bring it on.
There are four main, I guess, supporting points to how they've developed their, I guess, perspective on hell. And the first one's biblical coherence, or the overall meta-narrative to scripture. The second one is historical foundation, so the history of the church, and certain people who have supported a universalist approach to hell. The third one is an exegetically not dismissive perspective. And then the last one is it's in line with God's character and will. So here we go. Biblical coherence. As I guess the Bible rolls out, you start with common creation. Then you have the fall, Adam and Eve. And then God makes a way in covenant with Abraham. He cuts a covenant, so to speak, and this is God's way of redeeming the world through the nation of Israel. And then furthermore, Jesus Christ being the, I guess, the overall salvific source for all of humanity in the world. And then that kind of wraps up into the fourth point of, I guess, a biblical meta-narrative, and that's consummation. A consummation model, which is Jesus Christ, and then when he comes again. So I guess fleshing this out a little bit more.
Yeah, please do.
Yeah, common creation, right? And this isn't precisely the exact representation of their beliefs, but I guess I'll go through mine. You have common creation, okay? You have God creating the world, and then you have God dwelling with humanity, okay?
Okay, I'm with you so far.
Yep. And something went awry, so to speak. We don't know why. We don't know why there was a serpent in the garden. We don't know why there was a specific tree, but there was. And God commanded Adam to not eat of this tree. Whether it be symbolic or literal is not really the main point here, but creator, I should say, man fell.
Okay, so this is like a holistic view of
this is
scripture.
Exactly. This is, yeah, not getting the details. This is holistic. This is the general overarching theme, if you will,
of this view, this
sure view you're in. And generally speaking, a biblical worldview, and yep, not everybody agrees with this, but by and large. So you have the fall, and then God, as I described a little bit before, works to redeem this fallen world, okay? And that's first through Abraham, right, cutting a covenant. I don't remember the exact verse, but God says, or gives Abraham a command that you would be a light to the nations. And then if you go into, I guess, the overall nature of the Old Testament, you have Israel, which is literally the center of the world, representing almost the garden, right? Light to the world. God, so God makes a covenant with Abraham, gives him a land, and then gives him a purpose. And that's kind of God's initiation of making what's wrong right. As the story unfolds, though, it doesn't work out as such. It doesn't mean that God didn't plan to bring Christ, or this was a failed model, so to speak, but Jesus was the ultimate, you know, way God would redeem the world. And so he does. Jesus Christ dies on the cross for sin, as well as redeeming humanity and bringing us back to the Father, or bringing us back to our original purpose, and that was dwelling with God in creation, you know, before sin happened. And then the consummation model, that's, you know, when God or Christ comes back again and we all live happily ever after,
okay,
if you will.
So
how does hell fit into this?
Yeah,
is that okay?
I haven't heard that one.
Okay. Yeah. So from a traditionalist perspective, we have almost viewed hell as something, a holding grounds or a punishment for being sinful and not accepting Christ as your savior.
And you're speaking as them right now, right? Or are you just proclaiming this into the air?
Generally speaking, am I wrong?
No, I'm
just... Yeah. So, all right, no, and so that doesn't take into account what God's ultimate plan for creation is, and that is redeeming it back to its original purpose. Now, redemption, you know, is certainly for our sin, but it's not solely just that. I think, at least in American evangelicalism, and sometimes historically, we've made redemption strictly about sin. And it certainly is that, but it's much more broad perspective, at least from a meta-narrative point of view. So when it comes to hell, if we're going to simply think it's a holding ground or a punishment for being bad people or not accepting God, it kind of misses the point. And then in addition to that, if you look at, you know, how God punished or brought judgment upon Israel, you can see that, you know, they followed God, they fell away from God, God punished them, and then there is restoration and he brought them back. So it's kind of that we're ushering humanity back into that redeemed state, and it doesn't mean that there's going to be this holding ground called hell for the, you know, the rest of the ages to come. And this is where I don't fully agree with this point.
Okay,
of view.
So hold on.
So I'm kind of going.
So distill this down for me for a simple man's terms. I think there was about like 6 minutes of prep for the final conclusion, right? Which worries me from like an argument standpoint, right? When you have to frame it so terribly or so extensively. So what, in layman's terms, what is this universalist view? How does it talk about hell in particular?
Right. So can I do 2 more minutes of prep? three more points. I'm sorry. Okay.
Do
okay.
It.
So this is going to be a condensed. Here's the condensed version. Historical foundation, at least from the church fathers. Okay. Mm-hmm. So you have who we know to be universalists. We have Origen. Okay. Origen may have been a little sketch at times. You have Gregory of Nyssa. Mm-hmm. He was a universalist. And then strong probabilities. You have Clement of Alexandria. You have Maximus the Confessor. Isaac of Nineveh. I can't even pronounce this guy's name. Evagrius Ponticus. And then Theodore of Marusia. Not Theodore Jansen. And then there's a good chance that Athanasius may have been, but he was probably a conditionalist. Okay. And
so
then
these sound like Eastern fathers then. They're all kind of in the Origen school of thought is what I'm familiar with. Origen, for those who don't
generally
know,
speaking, yeah.
Very influential Eastern thinker in early Christianity, before the church was legalized by Rome. So before it had a lot of its like officialness really grounded in, because there wasn't tons of communication between the churches. He was extremely influential in the way the Eastern fathers thought, and Eastern meaning Egypt and the Holy Land and Syria, and even up to the north in Constantinople a little bit. So anything west of, or anything east of Rome is what Eastern means. Origen was condemned as a heretic by the Church Catholic for, you know, a while now, like since 400 AD, I think. So
who wasn't?
So just something to consider. I think some people would say that he doesn't deserve being called a heretic, but he's got some very unconventional views about the Bible in general. He was an early guy, so I don't blame him too much. But sounds like those all those fathers are really just caring after Origen, at least to me.
Sure. Yeah, no, hence the potential sketchiness of this character.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Credibility.
We should give slack to Christians of all shapes and sizes, especially in the early days, just because we have so many more resources than they do now.
Right.
Not passing judgment on this particular view of theirs yet. Just saying.
Fair enough. I will have one more point and I'll skip the last. So exegetically not dismissive. So I've got some scripture here. And I guess I'll read a couple and then list the rest. So you have 1 Timothy 2:4.
Hold on. Did you give the layman's view of what this hell is? I still don't know.
No, I'm still building it. And then I'm going
to... You didn't give him his 2 minutes.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm building it one more minute and then I'm going to tell you their perspective of what happens. Okay. So 1 Timothy 2:4, you have verses. This is good and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior. That was 1 Timothy 2:3, 2:4 here. Who desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Okay. You have 1 John 2:2. Oh my gosh. I just need to pull up my window again. 1 John 2:2. Here it is. He is the propitiation for our sins and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the world. So you have verses like this. You have 2 Corinthians 5:14, 1 Timothy 2:3-6, Hebrews 2:9, John 1:29, 3:17, 12:32, 2 Peter 3:9. These guys' perspective, these verses are talking about that meta narrative of what God intends to do with this world as it is. He created the world. He was dwelling with creation, with humanity. They fell, and he's working to redeem it back to his intended will. So, in general, here's the last point that what they believe hell is. And they couch it under, this is still evangelicalism, which you guys can be the judge of it. But hell is a place where punishment will happen. They do not dismiss that. It is a real place. People are going to be judged, but then God will bring them back into restoration at a point in time. But it is not eternal, and it is not going to be a forever thing. So, generally speaking, this is their foundation to their argument, and hell is definitely a real place. It will happen, but there's going to be restoration in the end.
Okay.
So that's the universalist evangelical perspective.
Here's some fleshing out that you might not know off the top of your head. Are Satan and his angels in hell also going to be redeemed?
I don't know. I didn't get into that.
Okay.
Yeah. It's a good question, though.
Differing views.
I'm sure. Yeah. I mean, there's different views on everything, right?
Right.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So I guess for the audience, that's Gregory MacDonald and Robin Perry.
All right. Well, thank you. Took a lot of prep just to say that people can't
I know,
out of
yeah.
No, it's good.
It's kind of anticlimactic, but you know, whatever.
Well, it helps us build. So what it did do is help us build the general biblical story, right? All the talk about meta narratives. I think we're all pretty much in agreement that. One, man has sinned. Two, that God redeems us through Jesus. And three, there's punishment for sins, even in this universalist view. It just, the question is the specifics of how that punishment is metered out.
Right.
Which should bring us to our second view of hell, which is going to be authored by none other than Theodore. Hey, Theodore.
The man behind the book.
Behind the book. Oh, bring the book.
A book by Edward Fudge.
So, called?
What a great name.
Fudge, yeah.
Honestly.
This will be a view purported by Edward Fudge and Chris Date and others, obviously.
What's it called?
Conditional immortality. Also, annihilationism. Also, some other names that some other people prefer. But the main one is annihilationism, and then probably the second main one is conditional immortality. So, Give an overview of this one to start. Conditional immortality basically states that our immortality is basically conditional upon God to give it. Like, we don't have life unless he gives it. And this goes back to Genesis 2:7, when God breathed into man and he became a living being. I got some verses too.
For God creating man? Man, no. You really are the man behind the book.
No. Proverbs 12:28 says, in the way of the righteous, there is life. Along that path is immortality. And 1 John 2:17. I don't have this up.
Can't believe we use notes. I just memorize all this. Just kidding.
Okay. The world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever. And then there's a bunch of other stuff. But I guess I won't go into that right now, because we'll probably have some discussion.
We will, for sure.
After this. So basically, only the saved are granted immortality, because God is the only indestructible being and immortal being, as the Bible says. And he preserves us and sustains us and gives us life. And then the wicked will be punished, but eventually they will become nothing. They will come to an end. They'll be completely consumed. They will cease to be forever. Things like that. So with conditional immortality, there is obviously room for very long torment if you take pleasure in that, or need to do that for the sake of justice. But then eventually there will be no more evil, per se. It'll be wiped out forever. And then new heavens, new earth. There will only be good. There will only be life and no tears and anything like that. And I suppose that's conditional immortality in a nutshell.
Sure, I've got a couple of then clarifying questions. Okay. Same question I asked Isaiah. Uh-huh. Satan and his angels, are they consumed in this model too?
I presume so, yes.
Okay. And you said that the new heavens and the new earth don't have the evil, right? So is hell in this view a separate place from earth, or is it like, is the new heavens and new earth not made until hell has run its course and burned everybody up?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Okay.
I'd just, have the same just standing question. The traditional view.
Yeah, and some things you don't know, right? Just in general, there's some mysteries you don't know. I was just wondering if they had a view. Okay. All right. So we've had a view of universalism from Isaiah, which says that
the evangelical view, Michael.
The evangelical view of universalism, which says that there is a hell, but is a temporary place of purging, and eventually you're restored to heaven. Then we've got annihilationism.
As Deuteronomy says, you must purge the evil among you.
Yep, which meant,
I'm the man behind the book.
Which meant killing
here
people.
All night.
Oh, all right. Then we had Theodore's view, his view that he presented is annihilationism / conditional immortality, right? Yep. And mm-hmm. that's saying that, same thing, there's eternal punishment. Oh, sorry, there is punishment. There is punishment, but it's not eternal, specifically not eternal. And then you cease to exist. So instead of being restored to Jesus and heaven, you are burned up to ashes.
Yeah.
All right. Well, for those of you screaming at your iPad or whatever you're listening to this on, I will present the traditional view of hell, which may put some of you at ease.
Which has eternal screaming.
Which has eternal screaming. And national teeth. I know people prefer. So, to those who are Christians, who've grown up in a Christian culture, is probably not going to be a strange view to you, but I'll present the traditional view of hell. the eternal view of hell, even as we previewed in Isaiah's little spiel, this is not necessarily 100% of all even real Christians agree, throughout the ages at least. I'd say for the past 1600 years, it's been pretty solid agreement on this issue, but there's always one-off people who are different.
Can I add something?
Sure.
Sorry, there's a mouse in here.
Great interjection, yeah.
Beep. Beep. And like you were talking about church fathers or previous people that might have believed this.
Oh, sure, yeah.
So I might throw in potentially Ignatius, and then also Irenaeus and Arnobius, as well as some others.
Are those all potentially, or you have?
Probably, definitely, Arnobius and Irenaeus, and then probably Ignatius.
Okay. Okay, so we got some pretty big name church fathers. I mean, I'm just going to give a preface, not to undercut anybody, but I have not read any of the early church fathers explicitly, and neither have any of us.
Correct.
Usually when you'll hear a lot of people make claims about early church fathers to say things that they believed, and usually it can be a huge point of contention in debates and is often very dubious as to what they believed, because people kind of want them to say a lot of things. There's a lot of push and pull on their different statements. So I wouldn't put all of your birds in one basket as far as them believing in the traditional view or the universal view or the conditionalist view, but this is just to say that these three views are pretty well known because they've been worked kind of throughout history. But again, the eternal view of hell, which is what I'm going to present, the traditional view, is the one that's won the day. A vast majority of Christians believe this, and so do a vast majority of historical Christians. So that's my beef. It's not like, you know, my trump card. It's just the facts. Anyways, so here's the gist of the eternal hell. First and foremost, the eternal hell is eternal. So just like both of your views that you presented, the eternal hell has creation of man. Man was good. Man fell to sin, which is an offense against God, and therefore needs restitution. And that restitution, as I believe, and this view believes, outlined in the scripture, is eternal separation from God. And that eternal separation is hell. And not only is it a separation from God, it's actually torment. It's actually agony for those who have sinned against God. So this view of hell is the one you'd usually think of. Now, I don't think it doesn't necessarily look like it would in the cartoons, as far as everything being on fire, or there being a red devil poking you with a pitchfork. But it is agony. It is called the eternal fire, the Gehenna, which is the word for consuming fire.
Wait, what did you say there?
Gehenna.
The word for consuming fire?
We'll get to the defense of these points in a little bit. But I'll read a couple statements from the scripture so you know where people even get this from.
Hashtag Edward Fudge.
So first and foremost, Jesus speaks about hell very often. In fact, some people will compile lists and say that he talked about it as his most talked about subject is hell. I'm just going to give a couple quotes about there being punishment. One of them, Matthew 13:50, and throw them into the blazing furnace where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That comes at the end of a parable of Jesus's. Mark 9:43, it says, it's better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands and go into hell with a fire never goes out. So there you go, another pretty strong view on hell there. 2 Peter 2:4, this is Peter talking about the angels, as you'll see. For if God did not spare the angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell, and interestingly enough, this is the only verse in the scriptures that hell is actually Tartarus in the Greek, which in Greek mythology is the realm lower than Hades, which is like the standard equivalent to Sheol, or just the realm of the dead in Hebrew. So Tartarus is certainly different than just regular death. It's, you know, hell. So it says, for if God did not spare the angels when they sinned, but sent them to hell, Tartarus, putting them in chains of darkness to be held for judgment. And then it goes on to speak, but that's the important part about hell. Another one about punishment is Revelation 21:8. It says, but the cowards, unbelievers, vile murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their share will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. And then another one from Revelation 22:15. Outside of the dogs, the sorcerers, the sexually immoral, the murderers, the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices lying. That is, they're outside the city that is promised to all believers. So that shows, I think, that this view of hell, at least, is showing that it's separate from where the believers are. So it's not a cohabitated place for the believers. And it is for those who come under judgment. It's a fire of some sort, whatever that's figurative or literal. It's some sort of fire that is being predicted. And it's a terrible place because Jesus says it's better for you to enter life maimed than two hands going to hell. Lastly, well, I've got a bunch of scriptures for this, but I think I'll save them for when we're actually discussing. An important note I will say as far as thematically, because you've got all that stuff about meta-narratives, right, is that the main defense besides the scripture for this view is that God in his justice demands eternal justice. So just like the righteous inherit eternal life, the wicked inherit eternal death. In fact, here's Matthew 25:46. It's Jesus again. He says, "Then they will go away to eternal punishment," the wicked that is, "but the righteous to eternal life." So that's the dichotomy that is set up kind of throughout the entire narrative of scripture. And here's Jesus saying it straight out that those who are judged and under the judgment of sin, their punishment is eternal. For example, if I sin against my sister, if I do something wrong against my little sister, my punishment is, you know, I get grounded or something, right? The punishment are kind of small because it's just my family.
Is your sister an eternal being?
She is. Well, okay. Yeah, no, she's not because she.
Because
she started to exist. So
Never mind.
She will be eternal, as far, and she will never end, right? Because we are all souls, but she didn't. She wasn't from time everlasting. If that makes any sense. Anyways, sin against a sister, small punishment because it's just my sister. Okay. Sin against my parents, bigger punishment. Okay, because it's my parents. If I sin against the state, I might go to jail. Right. My parents can't put me in jail, but if I sin against the state, I might get thrown in jail. Might even get put to death.
Hold on. Are we going out of the? Is this concluding your view or?
No, I'm just, I'm not. No, give me my 2 minutes.
Okay, so you need
give me my 2 minutes of meta-narrative, and then we'll jump in to the discourse here. So sin against my state, you know, the country, the nation, might get to jail, might go to death. So the consequences are going up, up, up.
Okay, well, but what if you murder your sister?
Then it's a sin against the state because the state says, do not murder. Whereas the state doesn't say, don't take my toys. Which is what my sister would tell me. And if I took her toy, I'd be sinning against my sister, right?
Isn't that stealing?
The state doesn't consider it stealing unless I like took the toys out of the house and then she sued me or something, right?
Michael's sister would have had to have written a contract.
Okay. Yeah.
Something along those lines.
Okay. Some deeds to those toys and see the documents.
All right.
Anyway, so going up and up, sin against my parents would be like staying out too late at night or maybe, you know, doing something they didn't want to do, and the consequences are bigger than if I just upset my sister. Upset the state, jail or death. Upset God. upset God. The consequences are bigger than the state, right? And so if you sin against the eternal God, a God who has ever been and is greater than anything and everything combined, your consequence is eternal. That's the general theme here. So you're not just a normal sinner against the state, you're sinner against God, right? So that's where the eternal view, I think, gets a lot of its backing philosophically, if you put it separate from the scriptures that support it. It's a eternal punishment because the sin was eternally great, which, I mean, in my humble opinion, should give us a grander perspective on the grace we've been given, because we were due eternal death, and now we get eternal life. So that's eternal hell. That's the traditional view. We've got the universal view. Universalist evangelical view.
Right.
And then the annihilationist conditionalist view. Now we should take off our Scooby-Doo masks and actually say what we believe. So I'll go first just because I just spoke. I am a believer in the traditional hell. Surprise, surprise. Isaiah, what are you?
I'm a traditionalist as well, but I have some nuances too.
Okay.
Whatever that means. We can talk about it.
And then what about I'm further down the prairie? But still touching the fence, but more on the side.
You're hemming and hawing on the fence.
Of conditional immortality.
Okay. So, yeah, that's not to say that any of our views are absolutely set in stone, like you were just saying, Theodore. which means we can have a discussion about it. So let's do it.
Oh, yeah.
So I'll stop talking. How about Isaiah? Why do you believe in a traditionalist view, and what are your nuances? And we get all the rights to interject and yell at you.
I object. I interject.
Yeah, this probably isn't the best logic, but I think it's fair logic in this standpoint. I think if you look at the words of Jesus, and if you've got the Messiah of the world saying certain things and cautioning you one way or the other, you ought to listen to it. And for me, that's strong enough evidence, at least from a biblical perspective, to hold more to a traditionalist view. Now, I think a nuanced perspective, I do like looking at scripture from a meta-narrative standpoint. So there were some attractive things to this universalist evangelical view that I do think evangelicals in general ought to think a little bit more in line with, just because we get so narrow focused with personal salvation and forget what God really is up to on a more grandeur theme, at least biblically. And so that would be my nuanced perspective, so to speak.
Is that you like the meta narrative of restoring everything?
Not necessarily. I think God is doing that. I do, but there are people who are going to rebel, and there are people, scripture lays this out, that hate God.
I could throw
go for it.
Yeah. Interjection. Counter interjection.
Okay.
Objection!
I yield my time back to you.
So are you interjecting?
Should I interject?
Interject.
Okay. Interjection. Just going to add a few more scriptures. A few more scriptural passages, verses. Luke 23:33-35. Well, okay. I actually don't have that up, but Jesus is on the cross and... So this verse might not have, or is not in every ancient manuscript or something like that. One of the Bibles gives that disclaimer. But this is when Jesus is on the cross and says, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." So who, one could wonder, like, who's being forgiven? And what will be the result of that forgiveness? And then in Acts 7:60, when Stephen is being stoned to death, his last words are, "Lord, do not hold this sin against them." And then Matthew 5:44, "Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you."
I'm gonna use my interjection then.
All right.
So I assume you're asserting with all these things, at least you're semi-asserting, that all sins are forgiven, which I think is the huge mistake here. Because when Jesus says, "Father, forgive them for they don't know what they do," I believe it's for crucifying the Son of Man, not for the gigantic list of sins they have behind them already. It's just crucifying, God's Son is pretty damning.
And then same thing for Stephen then?
Same exact thing for Stephen, yeah. I mean, Stephen's a normal martyr, so not quite the sin that it would be to kill Jesus, but still murdering God's one of God's elect. So that's why he's saying, forgive them this murder. They don't understand the gravity of murdering a saint, right? But they do know it's murder, so I really don't think that's
true.
That particular sin is taken from them, but the gravity of it being the Son of God or Stephen and a member of the elect, that's what they're asking for forgiveness for. But even then, there's still justice. I don't think that Stephen saying God forgive them means that there doesn't have to be God or justice metered out. It just means that Stephen is being nice. That's all.
Why is he being nice?
Because he himself is a murderer at heart, right?
He himself is... What?
It was a murderer at heart, so he knows the heart of those who stone him. I mean, he's a Jew before, so... Okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think he's a Jew before. I don't know. In any case, he has grounds to forgive them because he's not the ultimate judge, right? He doesn't even know the full extent of their injustice. So I don't think that injustice is wiped off the slate. I believe it all has to come under Jesus' blood, or it has to be atoned for in other ways. There's not a sin that goes out of existence just because of God's forgiveness. It has to be paid for because of his justice. It's not like justice is bigger than God is because God is just, and therefore there has to be justice. It just, who is that justice going to be put on? And you know, the answer for those who believe is Jesus Christ. But for any of those Jews who were or Romans or whoever was crucifying Jesus at the time, the sins that they had were not forgiven just because Jesus said you are forgiven. They had to come under Christ. Like when Jesus forgives sins, the man that comes down from the roof, for example, and he's paralyzed, mm-hmm. he says your sins are forgiven, you know, get up and walk, whatever. Those sins are forgiven because God is going to pay for them on the cross. Otherwise, they can't be forgiven because God is just. He'd be going against his character. He'd be leaving injustice in the land. So in any of these views, there has, that's why in each three of these views, which we didn't create ourselves, there is a justice. And that's exactly why the Bible talks about justice being in the end, whether it's conditional or eventually redeems the men or is eternal. There needs to be justice meted out. There's no free lunches where you sinned and nobody has to pay for it. Somebody has to pay for it. I know I'm going off on a gigantic tangent here. Just if you quote stuff like that, insinuating that those sins are passed with no punishment, that's wrong. Yeah. Big interjection. Sorry.
No,
no, it's good. Fine.
It's good, but discussion.
But like you said, didn't you say there's like a sense of justice in all these views?
Mm-hmm.
So really that could be...
Well, no, because you were trying to weaken, it seemed to me, at least you were trying to weaken the justice of God by saying, oh, look, well, he forgave even those who crucified him. Yeah, but justice still has to be like petered out. So even in conditionalist view or even in a universalist view, the sins of crucifying Christ still have to be paid for. So it's almost a non-issue that he forgives him on the cross as far as the eternal consequences of that go. That's what I mean to say.
Okay. I'm just thinking that the universalism view would say that Jesus' death on the cross, aka, or in essence, paid for every sin.
Not this one. Not the one we presented. Oh, no. There is a universalist view that believes that they never go to hell, but this one is saying that they're punished for the sins, which...
And that's what's unique about this perspective, is it takes into account the judgment of God or the justice of God, where I think they don't necessarily, where they don't have much of a foundation of is what happens afterwards. From a biblical standpoint, they don't have a foundation to justify they're eventually going to go to heaven or be restored again.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, that's what I gather. So I agree with what you're saying about justice. Right. You can't really have redemption and not have damnation, if you will, right? Because if you only have redemption, there's no damnation.
Put the meta narrative aside.
It just doesn't work.
Put the narrative aside. Yeah. I don't care if there's redemption. I mean, I do. I love redemption. We're all redeemed. But in this context, you don't need redemption for there to be judgment. You have a holy God. So that's where the judgment comes from.
Okay. At any rate, yeah. So,
for example, demons. They're not redeemed,
right?
But they're judged, right? Like I think that's almost the ultimate trump card as far as, for me, as far as the right and proof that God does judge things eternally, and putting all meta narratives aside, it's just the straight justice of God, is that, let me quote here, in Revelation, when not only is Satan and his demons thrown into the lake of fire, the same lake of fire that people are thrown into in the end, but here's a quote. Revelation 20:10, the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet are. And if you remember back in Revelation, the beast and the false prophet are people. I mean, you know, you can argue about what everything means, but I think most people would agree that those are people, regardless of your view in Revelation. So those two are already in the lake of fire when, you know, whenever Revelation happens, whether it's in the past or now. So the devil who deceived them is thrown into the same lake of fire that the beast and the false prophet are, where they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Yeah, that's Revelation 20:10. I'm not inserting words there. So the devil and his angels and the beast and the false prophet are there forever. They're never redeemed. So there doesn't need to be a redemption merit narrative for there to be torment forever and ever. And let me use this as a two-bird killer. Not only does this show that there isn't redemption for these particular beings, whether it's the devil or the false prophet or the beast, but they're also tormented forever and ever. in what I think is a showing of God's full justice against the injustices brought to the world by these three beings, at least, and all those thrown into the same lake, I would say, suffer the same fate. So that would show that God does not require a annihilation of souls. Like, mercy doesn't require that those souls be extinguished eventually, because here they are, tormented day and night forever and ever. And that's not the only verse where things are talked about forever and ever. I just think it's one of the most clear that shows that these aren't destroyed.
Yeah, Jonah was in the belly of the whale forever.
Nope. 3 days.
Well, that's what it's written in the Bible. So the conditional immortality view looks at Revelation and sees Revelation for, as they say, what it is, a vision and a spiritual experience to basically get a point across and be representative of what will come. So there's a bunch of parts in the Bible where it mentions like forever and ever, or everlasting and eternal, but obviously it's not so.
I know one about Edom in Isaiah, right? It's pretty pretty common one. I think I have it here in my notes too. Isaiah 34:9, it's talking about Edom. It says, Edom's streams will be turned into pitch, her soul into sulfur, her soil into sulfur, her land will become burning pitch. It will never go out. There's the forever language. It will never go out, day or night. Its smoke will go up forever. It will be desolate from generation to generation. No one will pass through it forever and ever. And we all, Edom's in, it's west of Israel, and it's not a burning place of sulfur, and people do pass through it. I would argue that it is a desolate place forever and ever. It is desert that nobody lives in, but yeah, I think there's hyperbole there, or at least some poetic use of the phrase forever and ever.
Yeah.
But I think our justification for saying that's not forever and ever is we see Edom. Right, we know it's not, so we can verify that that is poetic language. However, in Revelation, how are you going to verify?
Not sure how you're going to verify the vision or spiritual experience, but you can't really verify it either way.
Well, I would take it at face value, but unless we know otherwise.
You take revelation at face value?
Unless you can reasonably assert otherwise. Like, you would have to take the whole context of Revelation 20:10, where it says the devil who deceives him is thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, the beast and the false prophet are, where they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. You'd have to take it and somehow... Like, what's the argument for there that it's not literal?
Well, it's like the scripture interpreting scripture, because it's quoting Isaiah. And
it's not.
Let me go to another thing.
I mean, it does have fire and sulfur, which I think are biblical judgments, but that doesn't mean it's not the same punishment that Edom got.
2 Peter 2:6, talking about Sodom and Gomorrah, it says, if by turning the cities of Sodom and by turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah to ashes, he condemned them to extinction, making them an example of what is going to happen to the ungodly. So that kind of stands in direct contrast, I guess, to the eternal torment.
Oh, I don't think so.
Perspective.
I think those in hell are desolate, just like Sodom and Gomorrah.
Okay, now we're making our own definitions.
No, because you'd have to assert that Sodom and Gomorrah, they stand as a testament, right? You can go to Sodom and Gomorrah today. They are still the city sites. It's not like they stopped existing as city sites, that they are completely devastated, just like those in eternal torment will be.
Yeah.
So there you go. I don't think that proves
they were,
an annihilationist perspective.
Condemned to extinction. Making them an example of
that they would never live again. In hell will never live again, but they are conscious. They're not non-existent. For example, I think the conditionalist view, and you can even quote, you can continue to quote. I just, I like to talk. the dichotomy that I see a lot from annihilationist perspectives is that life means like consciousness, and that death means non-consciousness. But we all agree, even annihilationists, I think, for 100%, that we are dead in our sins, but we're not unconscious, right? Like our bodies are living, and then they eventually die, and the body's dead, right? It's no longer like active, rotting. Our souls were dead from birth, and yet our souls were still conscious. Like, I don't know about you guys, but I had a soul before I was saved and after I was saved, but it was a dead soul. It didn't mean that it was unconscious. It meant that it was dead to God. And when God tells Adam and Eve, you will surely die if you touch that fruit or eat of it, that day, they did die. Just their souls died. Were they still conscious? Yes, obviously, yes. So in the same way, when we die physically, our souls were dead from the first place. So yeah, they'll continue being dead. And a dead soul without a living body is one that is in Sheol and eventually judged in hell. That does not mean that it stops being conscious. So when the Bible talks about things living or dying, I don't believe it means becoming conscious or not. Like Sodom and Gomorrah, when it says mm-hmm. they're condemned to extinction, their physical existence destroyed, but their spirit obviously remained, because you can point to it and say, there's Sodom and Gomorrah, completely destroyed, right? So same for the sinner mm-hmm. in hell. You can say, there's whoever, there's Satan and his demons, there's the false prophet, there's the beast, burning in hell, completely destroyed, because they have no physical body, no physical presence, and they're completely spiritually dead. So there they are, not living. But they're conscious, they're just not living.
One thing, and Michael, I think that's a good out. You laid it out on the table, so to speak, and I think that's pretty legit. And that's where I would say my more nuanced version of what I think hell is comes into play. Like, it's not just this arbitrary God up in heaven deeming, you know, those people to hell, these people to heaven, you know, just so his justice can be satisfied. Well, God is a just God, and he's going to make sure this is true. There's a level of, hey, these people are dead in their sins. It's almost like they're in a living hell themselves, that they are dead. And I think that's where like Adam and Eve, they're dead to their sins, or, you know, for instance, in Revelation, again, I forgot the verse, but like where those people call the rocks to come down and fall upon them so that they don't have to see the face of God. Mm-hmm. Like, there's this element of, they hate God. They are obsessed with, you know, their own lives that they're dead to. And then those who, you know, in Christ are reconciled to God have found life. And that there's this element of, you know, heaven, yes, a physical place, but working towards and being redeemed, like reconciled to God. So
you should be fully redeemed if you're in heaven, I would hope.
No, absolutely. But there's also this element of quite a literal spiritual death and a living hell because of it.
If we didn't have any verses about hell, except that it was a place where unbelievers go afterwards, I would probably agree with you. But the descriptions of hell aren't just a self-punishment. I actually think that they are,
I think it's a physical place for sure.
Well, the descriptions of them, it's not just a place where people are apart from God. I think it is a place where they're punished for their sins. Is there that big of a difference, like as far as how you apply the teaching about hell, whether it's a terrible place to be if it's apart from God and eternal, or whether God's punishing you in hell eternally? There's not a huge difference as far as application goes, but I think the images of hell are God's judgment on them. So it's not just leaving them in their death. Like Sodom and Gomorrah, terrible places, right? Living in Sodom and Gomorrah was a punishment in of itself. Would you agree?
Yeah, yeah.
But he destroyed them. He brought fire and sulfur from heaven and absolutely wiped them off the planet in judgment. So this, I think the same thing applies in hell, that, yeah, I think Sheol, before anybody's sent to hell, just the land of the dead, terrible place, right? You don't have a body, and I think people are made to have bodies, so being outside of a body is bad enough, but you're also dead in your sins, so double whammy, okay? Bad place. Hell, is you're actually receiving the wrath of God. So Sodom and Gomorrah, bad place. You don't want to be there. Destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, you definitely don't want to be there, right? Sure. Because that's under the wrath of God.
Okay.
Yeah, so Theodore, I cut you off totally.
I got some more verses.
Yeah, lay it on. And again, for the audience out there, I keep in mind that life and death don't mean what they might be asserted to mean. That's all. Okay, you can do it. Lay it on us, Theodore.
So Psalm 37:28 says, "For the Lord loves the just and will not forsake his faithful ones. Wrongdoers will be completely destroyed. The offspring of the wicked will perish." Psalm 145:20 says, "The Lord keeps all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy." And then 1 John 2:17, to include some New Testament stuff as well. I have a whole bunch of Old Testament stuff. But, "And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does the will of God abides forever." So once again, I just see many more verses for like the complete cessation eventually of wicked. Like,
well, we all agree that they die on earth.
Yeah.
So they are ceased. They are destroyed.
Mm-hmm.
They do cease to be. They do pass away.
Yeah, but you're saying that's only physical?
Yeah, I'm saying that it's supported. Support a spiritual full destruction if you want to go that far, but it's not ceasing to exist. And I don't think it supports annihilationism. Those verses, though I know they're quoted, I don't think it actually supports annihilationism.
How would that act out if it was a spiritual destruction?
Well, we're dead. What do you mean?
Like, what would a spiritual destruction look like?
Being cast into hell. Eternal torment.
That's more of a physical.
What's consciousness?
Right? No.
Like,
well, I mean, it is a physical destruction, but it's also you're tormented. I mean, that's death.
But it has to do with the physical, not necessarily the spiritual.
No, because there's two deaths, right? We all died spiritually with the fall. Like I was just kind of laying out. We all died spiritually with the fall. That's a death. It's not a fake death. It's not a non-real death. You are dead in sin.
Right.
And therefore, that's what spiritual death is, right? And imagine you're spiritually dead and you're under the wrath of God. That's hell. You physically die too in hell. Obviously, we all die one death and then the second death. That's why it's called the second death. Mm-hmm. If you go into hell, of course. Everlasting life is when you're raised again and you're not, you know, sent to hell.
Right.
I just need some clarification on what you believe to be like the new heaven, new earth, and what exactly is this consciousness yet without a form or something, just being tormented?
Well, you might have a form. I mean, I don't think there's enough in the Bible to say what the particulars are of hell as far as... I mean, everybody's raised again. So this is my view of eschatology as far as the very end of things go. And even I have some scripture here. Let me just go through the scripture and then I'll lay it out in layman's terms.
Okay.
Hebrews 9:27 says, "And just as it is appointed for people to die once, and after this on judgment, so also the Messiah, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to bear sin, but to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him." So I think this verse shows that you die once and then you're judged. There's you don't live a second life and then die again. Important to know if you're coming from no base here. Revelation 20:13 says, "The sea gave up its dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them, and each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death, and anyone not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire." I think this shows that, first of all, Hebrews says that it's appointed for people to die once, and then after this judgment, here's Revelation saying that when you're dead, eventually there'll come a final judgment in the sea, and you know, wherever you died, if you're in Hades or wherever, you're given up to God, and each person was judged according to what they had done, and then there's no more Hades, there's no more sea, there's no more temporary resting place. Those are thrown into hell, and so are all those not found written in the book of life, and that's called the second death. And then and my last quote here is Revelation 20:10. So when I already said, "The devil who deceives them is thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever." And that is to say that The devil's thrown in there in final judgment. The beast and the false prophet were thrown in before him. So it's not like it's not a place until then, until final judgment. It's a place. It's just, you know, I think it's reserved for certain people until the very, very end of judgment. Anyways, so here's the plain man order of how I see people being judged. I see from Revelation specifically the death of all people normally, like we die spiritually and then we're put in a holding place, whether that is Hades, like Sheol, which is a place for the dead, or heaven, where if you're one of God's elect, straight up heaven because you're God's and he knows you, right? So no holding place for you anymore. But the rest of the dead are in Sheol. Then, at the end of days, at the final judgment, everyone is raised physically from the dead. Some people will come at me for this because they don't believe this for non-believers or whatever. I believe everyone's raised physically from the dead to face judgment, okay, before God. Their souls were conscious in Sheol, wherever. Not a super strong view, but as seen in the parable of Lazarus and the rich man, the rich man is conscious in Sheol. There he is, suffering in Sheol. So he's not gone. And you can even see, like,
there's a lot of problems with that, but
well, keep just going. General existence after when you're not in the body, I think, is shown in the Bible pretty readily. Like, the prophet Samuel is raised by the witch when Saul inquires of the witch. She raises Samuel, not by her own power, but Samuel comes and he's not in bodily form, right? But he's there, he's conscious, and it is Samuel. He gives a true prophecy to Saul. So there's life after death, right? You're not, even though you don't have a body, you're still conscious. Anyways, back to the order of things. Die once, normally. God raises everyone from the dead, and then they're all judged according to what they've done. If they are not found written in the book of life, so if they haven't been covered with the blood of Jesus, they are thrown into the lake of fire, with their body and soul, everything they are, into the lake of fire. Okay? And that's when I don't know what happens to them as far as, like...
I don't think anybody knows.
Well, we know that they're conscious. I would argue we know that they're there. They're conscious and they're suffering. But what we don't know is, like, is their body preserved, but they're burning and, like, it hurts physically? Or is their body burnt up, but then they're still there suffering, like, in their soul? I don't know. But that's, you know.
Yeah, you tell me.
Yeah. Does that answer your question, Theodore, about the order of things here that I believe?
Mostly. I'm still debating the eternal sustaining conscious existence stuff.
Yeah, I mean, so here's my humble opinion about, like, the influences behind each of these views. I think it's pretty fair to say that the influence behind universalism, the influence behind not wanting an eternal hell, is that we all have mercy for each other, right? And we don't want to see people burn in hell forever. Now,
so this guy actually says that's not his reason.
Yeah,
because he just loves restoration.
No,
also,
no.
The conditional immortality people are going to say whatever Michael's going to say about them is not what brought them to conditional immortality. Like, it's not our sense of, wow, God's so unjust, it can't be this way. But obviously from Scripture, you can get to any of these views.
Arguably. It's just...
You have to debate.
I don't think you can get there. I don't think you can get to a universalist view from Scripture.
So I'll give a direct quote from this guy. He says, "There is serious conflict between traditional interpretations of the Bible and reason. I ought to restate that by reason, I do not refer to human autonomous reason, but reason informed by the self-revelation of God testified in the Bible. We must be open to the possibility that we have misread the Bible. It is time that biblical scholars looked again at this question." So, I don't think mercy, if you will, is driving this type of universalist evangelical perspective. It's more so like, what do you do with verses that God wills that all creation would come to the knowledge of Him?
And we've been
through
this.
We've been down this road before. But like this meta narrative perspective, like, he brings up the question: does this not mean God has proven unwilling or unable to save all that He desires? right? So I guess self-contradicting statements in scripture, so to speak.
Yeah, but it's not, right? Because God has two wills, just like we have two wills, right? You can will something enough to do it. Like, I want to eat this apple. And so I reach out and eat the apple, right? That's an active will. But I also have prescriptive wills. Like, I don't want Barack Obama to have a third term in presidency or something like that. But what if I don't go vote? I still wanted it. Like, I still willed it, but I didn't go vote for it. In the same way for God, right? He wills that all men repent. He also wills that no one sin, but obviously people sin. So that's where you get the principle that God has a active will that he acts on, and then he's got a prescriptive will. Well, you can call it passive, but it's prescriptive. Prescriptive. Yeah, he's prescribing that no one sin. He prescribes that no one perish but have eternal life, but he doesn't act on it because people do perish.
Right. Okay. Well, obviously this guy doesn't see it that way.
Yeah, well, I see where I don't want to be super unfair as far as saying that, oh, well, they're just babies and they don't like hell as a concept, and that's the entire reason why they picked their thing. But, call me suspicious, but it's not like I really like the view of traditional hell, and that's why I picked it. As far as like who likes an eternal hell, because we're all sinners. So we all could have been in that exact same boat without the grace of Christ. So why are we like super stoked that people burn forever and it's terrible?
That's why we're laughing on air, okay?
No, yeah. That's why I'm laughing.
Yeah. Come on.
But we're not. I mean, there's not the motivation that I just want to see people burn. And to be honest, even the most masochistic person, I don't think that's particularly motivating for getting them to believe this. However, I think it can't be ignored, the motivation that comes from conditionalism, that comes from universalism. Again,
by and large, it would probably be a mercy motivation, by and large. But it's not, as Steve pointed out, like, there are things in scripture that...
Yes.
Scripture says, I, for my own sake, blot out your transgressions and remember your sins no more.
But how does he do that? Again, so this is why I don't, I really,
and then picking and choosing Bible verses.
I'm so highly suspect of this view, and it's no offense to you, Theodore. A view that misuses scripture like that is super highly suspect, because when God says that, is the insinuation that he is blotting out sin with no punishment? Because obviously there's punishment. It all gets on Jesus. If you have a God who isn't just and who just blots out sin and like there's no, with nothing. He just says, I'm going to throw that in the cosmic garbage can and there's no punishment. Uh-huh. You have an Allah, That's what Allah of Muslims does. There's no punishment for sin if you repent. He's just like, yep.
Wait, so what is our punishment?
Our punishment is laid on Jesus. Exactly. And that's the necessity for Jesus, yeah.
Exactly. So what are we arguing?
It's just flown out into the wind, like it's never served, so to speak.
Well, it's served on Jesus.
If it was served on Jesus, you wouldn't have to go to hell. That's why it doesn't really. That's why it's a misnomer. That
we aren't going to hell because it's on Jesus.
If you're an annihilationist, you're not going to heaven. It means the blood of Jesus was not applied to you. So if your sins are actually blotted out, you'd be going to heaven. That's why it's a total misnomer. It's, I think, a red herring. I think it's an intentional false teaching to say that kind of sin applies to annihilationism, because it doesn't. That kind of verse, a verse that says, "I'll blot out your sins and remember them no more," mm-hmm. is not supportive of an annihilationist view.
And I wasn't.
Well, I think people do use it, but clearly it doesn't pan out correctly.
Sure. It's just representative of God's character.
Well, he does. The Bible narrative is that he does redeem us, right? It's not a hopeless narrative just because there's a hell.
Can I ask a clarifying question? Or Thea, do you have something?
No, you can go.
Okay, this is a quote by, his last name is Burke, and he states this, it's the traditionalist view. It says, "God's justice demands eternal torment as the only appropriate response to sinners." Mm-hmm. I think you would agree with that statement.
Yep.
And it's not necessarily because we believe that is the only way justice is to be served, but it's because it's the way God has chosen that justice is served in this way. Is that correct?
I don't know all the different types of ways justice could be, but yeah, it's the way it's going to be metered out. Yeah.
So, and that's my clarifying question is, it's not because that's what we think or how we think justice should be served, but it's because how God chose it to be.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Fair enough.
So Theodore, we cut you off. You're going to say a bit more scripture for us, the man behind the book?
Sure.
And we should probably wrap it up here. So maybe we'll give you last word, Theodore, because we've been bashing you and your opinions.
Hebrews 10, 38-39. But my righteous one will live by faith. My soul takes no pleasure in anyone who shrinks back, aka anyone who is destroyed. And then here I'm in the Greek interlinear part. But we are not of those shrinking back toward destruction, but of faith toward the preserving of the soul. So, once again, I would just say that it seems the preserving of the soul eternally, like actually eternally, is meant for those with faith. Whereas shrinking back to destruction, I suppose might apply to, I forget where it is, but like the body or dust will return to the ground and the soul will return to the spirit, or the soul will, or the soul or spirit will return to God who gave it.
So what, do you become God again? Like a Nirvana thing? Whatever. No. I'll let you have last word here. Like, where does the soul go?
I would think that that means that God takes away the breath of life.
And where does it go?
That he breathed in to us.
Does he become God again? Does it become God again?
No, you nobody becomes
sucking
God.
Sucking up like a spaghetti needle?
But God can take breath as he gives breath. That's his prerogative. And then another thing was, Genesis 6:3 says, God is saying, my spirit will not contend with humans forever, for they are mortal. And then Isaiah 57:16 says something similarly, I will not contend forever, nor will I always be angry. So if evil, if sin is sustained, and punishment is continually given because sin is perpetual and is eternal, then how is God not contending with that forever?
Well, I have to say, I think that that particular verse from God is saying that with mankind, he won't be angry forever. And he's not. He redeems a people for himself.
But he is angry with most of mankind, presumably, forever.
You don't know that it's most, but sure.
Okay, but we do know that it's at least one in the traditional view of hell.
Yes, and what I'm saying is I don't think that verse is saying that he will not be metering out justice forever. I think that, because obviously he's just forever, that's an inherent nature of God, but it means that mankind, he won't be turned against forever. Because at the time he was saying that, you know, it was wicked mankind time, right?
Sure.
And he's not. He's redeemed us. Therefore, he's the anger, the wrath of God has been turned from us, the elect.
But there's more wicked than elect. Still.
But yes, so God is no longer angry with all men, and therefore he won't be angry forever with men. He has redeemed us, and therefore he's no longer angry with us.
He was never angry with all men. Like all as in 100%.
Well, with mankind, I think that, you know, that's why he wipes out them out of the flood.
Yeah. And like Sodom and Gomorrah and Nineveh and such.
Yeah, those are specific groups of men. Okay, well, we're going to start meandering everywhere. So do you have any, I guess that's your last words? Well, you've got many. I know you're the man behind the book. All right.
The books.
Well, for those of you listening, thanks for holding there. I know it's a little longer episode, but obviously we have strong opinions on this. You know, I think we all encourage you to explore the scriptures yourself. Each of you really does take into account scripture. They don't ignore scripture. All three. Like Bereans, dig into the scriptures and figure out what you believe for yourself. Of course, pray about it, but explore the scriptures and see what they say. Don't be convinced by one or two off-quoted verses for any of the sides. Make sure that you get a holistic view of scripture. So thanks for listening. This has been The Found Cause. where we found our cause in serving the Lord Jesus Christ. We have lots of opinions on this show. I've been Michael, the man behind the machine, the maniacal masochist who loves hell. And this is...
Isaiah the Heretic.
So that's your nickname's going to be, all right?
No, I'm kidding.
And Theodore behind the Edward Fun Book.
Cool. Peace. Thanks for watching. If you want to see the rest of our podcast, you can go to foundcause@podbean.com or on our YouTube channel, Found Cause on youtube.com. See you next time. Bye-bye.